Straight, meaning led outside of what the direct will of God is. And so God was showing me this morning that mamas, y'all are the direct link for daddies and their kids. And we've seen it done at great rate in history, as well as day to day. And we've seen it done wrong a lot of times in day to day, as well as history. And so we have to celebrate y'all because, first of all, we know we can't be here without mama. Mm-hmm. Can't be here. Now, most of you don't know that that is pretty important in that process that y'all get into. Okay? And so we're going to leave that alone, and y'all figure that rest of that stuff out as you get over. And we're going to let that go. Okay? And so I thank God that we celebrate moms because you need to be celebrated. Because oftentimes that responsibility of rearing the kids falls directly on you because if daddy's doing it right, daddy's out here trying to make sure that the money's coming in so that mama is more visible to be able to help rear y'all and help raise y'all. Amen? Does that make sense? Any questions? Okay. And so I thank God, and like I said, prayerfully, anybody that still has a mama will be celebrated in some sort of way today. If it's nothing more than a humongous, genuine, I love you and hug and kiss and a big old gigantic, as we used to give you one of the big service back in the day, all over your face, you know. But anyway, I thank God because you deserve to be celebrated. Amen. And so, God being God today, I don't know if you recognize, and this is some of the things that we were dealing with this morning, it's just recognizing spiritual warfare. That's something that we were talking about and dealing with this morning, was talking about spiritual warfare and how, as children of God, we are faced with this. And as God begin to work with you and you begin to grow deeper, that is so funny, as you begin to grow deeper in the Lord, you find out that God begins to show you warfare. And so we was dealing with that this morning. So that I want you to understand that while you're going through your life, there will be seasons where God will begin to show you spiritual warfare. He will begin to show you spiritual warfare on other people. But this is what God gave you this morning, y'all. Looking at this text, the 23rd division of Solomon. No, 32nd division of Psalm. Oh, man, I want you to understand something as a child of God, that we're covered. We're covered. And so, not ready to go directly into where we're coming from this morning, but it's something about knowing that my current situation, my current place, my current existence, my current state of what I'm fighting on today is not the end of the story. You understand what I mean? See, I don't know about y'all. The word of God says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. You know what it means? Anybody? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. If you think about the first portion that I said before the comma, all have sinned. Everybody has sinned. Huh? Say it again. All the children of God, everybody. Those that accept God, those that don't accept Him. Everybody messes up every day. Every day. How do I know? Because the Bible tells us that we got to die daily. So that means every day we're going to miss it. Because if you didn't miss it every day, you wouldn't have to continue to die, right? When the dying is not laying out and being buried in dirt. It's talking about dying to the flesh and allowing the Holy Spirit to dominate in your life. And so when Bob says we die daily, that means that we must die daily. That means that every day you have to chip off something in you and allow God to dominate. You see what I'm saying? Let go of the way you see it and pick up the way God sees it and walk in His way. And you got to do this every day. You might conquer it this week and next week. You might conquer it this week and next week you're faced with it and you might not do as good. And so you got to go back and read it. And then Tuesday is another day to redo something else. And then Wednesday is another day. And it's like this until you finally, however long it takes, get to the point that it doesn't bother you no more. Get it? Now it's like it's not even a temptation anymore because you've allowed the Holy Spirit to dominate. But so anyway, going back to this text that God was giving me and prepping us for us this morning, that it's a blessing to know that you're covered. Because when he says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, then the only ones that have already got the victory is those that have accepted Jesus Christ. And this is the beautiful thing. So that means that as a child of God, okay, as a child of God, this constantly, as the word of God tells us, to press toward the mark of a higher calling, this means that every day there is, I'm walking in the victory of knowing that I'm already going to get out of my situation. You get it? Every single day, I don't care what I'm faced with, every day there's a sin, right? So every day, whatever I'm dealing with, I know that as a child of God, God is prepping me for the victory over it. I may not understand that right now. It's like, God, why do I keep doing it? God, why does this thing has got me so bad? Every day we're getting closer if we continue to die dead. God, I'm going to mess up today, but I'm yours. I'm yours, God. I ain't going nowhere. Be like, yep, cool. I'm coming in a little bit more. You see what I'm saying? And so every day it's like having a vacuum cleaner, right, on the inside of you. And every time the Holy Spirit, every time you submit your will to God, the Holy Spirit is like, clean up a little bit more dirt. And he said, yeah, I'm going to get the whole house clean now. I'm almost full in. And so that's what it's like for a child of God, is knowing that you are covered. And the battle that you're dealing with is not the one that's going to take you out. Nothing, because you already got the victory. Does that make any sense? You sure? Is that a blessing? Is that a blessing? It's a bona fide, as they say, bona fide blessing to me. Because religion tells me that if I continue to stay in my mess, I'm dying. And I'm going to go to hell. But God looks at the heart. And so although I may be in my mess, he knew I was going to be in some mess because he said all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And he also knew I was being messed daily because I got to die daily. Is that making any sense to you? Kind of, sort of, not really. Check this out. Let me put it down as clear as I can for you. Nothing against you, but I understand your thought process is a little different than most people in the room, okay? I got you because of your age. Nothing against you. We all been nine before, okay? So, what I'm saying to you is every day God knows you're going to sin. You're going to mess up, okay? But guess what? Because of Jesus, Jesus died for all our sins, past, present, and future. And whatever sin that you may deal with, even if you deal with this sin for a long period of time, God every day, because if you continue to continue to spend time with God, continue to talk with him, and continue to let the Holy Spirit lead you, he knows, God knows, and you can prompt him, and it's a blessing to know that every day is getting you closer and closer to walking out of that sin. See, right now, you might not understand it, but there are some things that may come on you to be a bondage. And it might hold you for a few years. Am I telling them? And you said, damn, man, that's no way that don't make sense. That somebody could ask you to get caught up in something or sin and stick with the sin for years. Keep living. You see it, and you'll be faced with the decision to whether you want to be a part of a sin for a long period of time. And so I thank God this morning that he's letting us know that guess what? We're walking in victory as a child of God. You're walking in victory, yes, because of Jesus Christ, but you're walking in your victory because what's happening is every day as you continue to spend time with God and you continue to get your spirit stronger. Let me ask you, so what happens if you go all day and don't eat? In the natural. You'd be hungry. How's your body react to not eating?
Weaker.
Huh?
Your body will get weaker.
Yeah. Say it again, but lie.
Your body will get weaker.
You get weaker. Guess what? It's the same way in the spirit. Mm. You go all day and don't spend time with God. You don't pray. Don't allow him to talk to you. Don't get away and just meditate, read his word, and just think about him. And you get weaker and weaker and get weaker. And now, just like if you don't never eat in the natural, eventually you pass out and just lay there and you ain't got no strength in the nest. It's the same thing in the spirit. You don't ever feed your spirit, you get so weak, man. The next thing you know, you just laid out. And the devil's like, yeah, I can kick it now. He can't do nothing about it. But as long as you continue to feed your spirit, what happens is you continue to walk through your into your victory. Because you're getting your spirit stronger. And you're getting stronger. And you're getting stronger. And day by day, you're going to eventually get to a point where it's like, oh, no, I ain't even dealing with this no more. I ain't dealing with it no more. I don't even see the point. Mm-hmm. Amen? See, what happens, and then you might still be in a place where your mind wants it because it remembers how that's how we used to feed our emotions. And so now is at the point of them renewing your mind so that now you understand that this action only hurts me. It doesn't bring any kind of help. You get it? It'll make more sense later on. We got a song. We're going to go into what God has given us this morning. We're going to go into the song. And then we're going to go a little further after that.
Yeah.
life. There was a season in my life, and some of y'all heard me say, I did not understand the purpose of Jesus. Remember I used to say that? I used to ask y'all all the time. I said, Mama, I don't understand. I don't understand the purpose of Jesus. I knew he died on the cross, but I did not understand that without Jesus, we would have never got back to the Father. You see what I'm saying? Without Jesus, we would have never been able to get back linked to the Father. And then again, I got to go back. I'm telling you, when God was giving me that, it just was reminding me that, remember I said that oftentimes God teaches in the natural to show us spiritual. And as God was giving me that thing, like I was sharing with you earlier this morning, that the mom is usually the direct link from the kids to the children. Well, it's the same thing for Jesus. Jesus is the direct link to God. And if a father's standing like he's supposed to, amen, he's going to make sure that his family knows about the Lord. Amen. And the mom is bringing that thing down to the kids. Mom, we was in church, but I didn't quite understand exactly. And mom's like, let me tell you, let me get these kids Bible out for you, and let me begin to show you what this means. Amen. And so I thank God that he has made sure that we all understand how he maneuvers, and he shows us this in the natural every day. We live it. Amen. We live it. Just like something I told you blew my mind during this new Resurrection Sunday, just about how the S-U-N is a representation of the S-O-N. And oftentimes now, because God showed me that, how I like to get in the sunlight first thing in the morning when the blinds up, and I just can feel the presence of God, because I can feel that rays of sun on my, you know, my eyes, so I can still feel it. And it's not that, okay, I like standing in the sunlight, you know. But if you pay a lot of attention, a lot of people do. They like to stand in the sunlight. And guess what? But that's a representation of standing in the rays and the power and the anointing of the S-O-N. Amen. And that's what's so powerful, because when we stand in the presence of God and we standing in that presence and that direct linkage to the Father, which is that anointing, and standing in the body of Christ, while we're standing there, y'all, I'm telling you, this is why it's so powerful to meditate on the Lord, that when we're standing there, that's when stuff begin to fall off of us. You see what I'm saying? They say that the body needs a lot of vitamin D, which comes from the sun. And the body operates real good when you get that vitamin D in your body. It helps your joints and helps all this stuff maneuver a lot better. But guess what? There's something powerful about when we get that anointing from the S-O-N and we stand in the presence, and now a lot of stuff begin to fall off. And our life begin to operate a whole lot better because we're standing in the presence of the S-O-N. Man, you see the direct relationship of what God is showing us every day that's supposed to lead us back to the Father. Everything that God does is supposed to lead us back to him. Every single thing he does, the going to the job and making money, is supposed to lead us back to him, because when we get that paycheck, instead of stressing out saying, what am I going to do with it, we're supposed to first give God thanks for it. Amen? And in the Old Testament, it was a mandatory law, a spiritual law, that you pull your 10% out of, to make sure that you didn't forget to give God his. In the New Testament, the first thing we should be able to do is just praise God. God, I look at this check, and I don't know what to do with it. God, if you want 10, I give you 10, but whatever you tell me to do with this thing is what I'm going to do with it. Amen? And so, now you look at this thing and you say, God, thank you. Not what most of us do. Woo, I was hard for this. I pulled doubles for this. I did this. I knew my kids needed this, so I worked hard to make sure she has a new shoe. No, we missed it, because what we did is elevated ourselves and forget to give God glory. Because I can tell you the honest truth, I have worked all week long and didn't receive a paycheck. Don't that sound weird? It don't sound weird. You really been paying attention. That's happened to me multiple times. I've worked hard all week long, for long hours, and at the end of the week, I don't even receive a paycheck. A couple things happened. Either payroll messed up and they didn't give me my check, or something crazy happened at the end of that week, and all the money I've made, now I got to spend it in expenses trying to fix my truck. So, just because leave God out of your situation and it's going to prosper. It won't work. Amen? And so again, I thank God that he has a way of making sure we understand how important he is in the factor of life. Make sense? Does? Amen. So I guess you want me to go pick that up. Please. Say that again. Say it real loud. Amen. I think I do. All right, so now, God being God, now check this out. God being God, and God gave us the title on the day out of the 32nd division of Psalms about walking in victory. Now, we've been talking about this this morning, about walking in victory. You might have heard some of it. I can't exactly remember. I don't have an outline. I don't know. But walking in victory, just understanding that regardless of what you're going through right now, if you stay connected to the Son, if you stay connected, then you are actually stepping every day to closer and closer to the finish line in your particular, but in your specific situation. And I can think of things, and listen, I'm gonna tell you, I know my youngsters here didn't quite catch on to it, but there are situations in my life, not understanding and not knowing what trap the devil had laid out for me, that I had walked into a walk. God gave me this one too. Listen to this one. Listen to this one real carefully. There were situations that, y'all. I'm going to go ahead. I can remember at a young age, I was introduced to pornography. And I can remember at a young age that I freely walked over into the category of pornography. And what happened is, once I freely walked to it, there was a demon there that grabbed hold to me. And I freely walked over to it, I didn't realize that a demon had took hold of me and was pulling me deeper and deeper and deeper in darkness. I freely walked there. God gave me the ability to choose. And out of curiosity, I walked there. Amen? So now, just like that demon was able to grab me like that because I freely made a choice to walk over into it by curiosity or whatever it was, I had the freedom of choice to walk the other direction. And as I began to walk towards the Lord, the Holy Spirit grabbed me and began to pull me out of darkness. You see what I'm saying? I had a freedom, I had a choice. You see, the old school way of saying it is, if you make one step, God will take it too. That's the old school way of saying it. But it let me know that I had a freedom to choose the direction to walk in. And as I began to walk in the right direction, the same spiritual law took effect. And the Holy Spirit grabbed me and began to pull me and take me closer and deeper into light. And then as I got closer and deeper into light, now we got to a place where God began to show me how it did benefit my life to walk in darkness in that area. And what the devil was trying to take from me by walking in there. Now, as we were talking about earlier, it's time to renew the mind. Because the mind remembers what I used to use pornography for to try to ease the pain from stuff that was bothering me. And understanding that it didn't ease the pain, all it did was deepen the wound. And I didn't realize it. And so what God began to do as I started to walk with him, he's taking me over into light. And as he's taking me over into light, he's beginning to do the opposite of what the devil was doing. But so now, when the wound was so deep, God began to heal the wound. And I began to now no longer use pornography to cater to my flesh trying to heal an emotion, but I began to put the right antidote into that wound. You just had a rash on your arm, and we said when we get to the house, we'll put the right stuff on it, right? And then what we say, we get to the house, we'll put the right stuff on it. Well, guess what? When I got closer to the Lord, he began to put the right stuff on that wound. And what I needed was his ointment called anointing. Amen? Guess what? And so when God began to heal me with the right stuff, what happened was now I didn't look to the old stuff to help me. I started looking more to him. And guess what? As I walked out of it, just like I made a conscious choice to walk in, God, I made a conscious choice to walk to the Lord. And the Lord began to lead me to the victory line in that. Amen. He began to lead me to the victory line of being delivered from it. Amen. And so now, as the enemy, because temptation is always present. It's always present. And so when the devil tries to try to tempt me with, remember, this used to make you feel better. No, but no, you were right. That's the renewing of the mind. That's a lie. I found out a different way. So now I got to make the conscious choice because one or the other is asking for action. Am I telling the truth?
Amen.
One or the other walk is asking for action. And so as the old school, where the new school is, when you know better, you do better. That's new school. And so now I understand that you're trying to get me, devil, you're trying to get me to act. But God has already shown me a better tool, so let me act by going to him and begin to praise him and worship him and begin to recognize that the devil just trying to steal from me. Because he don't do it. Say it, I hear you. Go ahead. What does he do? He come to do what? Say it loud. Say it one more time for my 9-year-old. That's all he knows how to do. Amen? And so then when God begins to show me that, that I understand it. Wait a minute, devil. I got to renew my mind. I can't mess with you. You're trying to steal the intimacy between me and my wife. You're trying to kill my desire for my spouse. And you're trying to destroy my marriage. Oh, man. When God begins to show you some stuff, and you're like, it ain't that serious. Oh, that's what he wants you to think. Amen? And so God is God being God. He leads you and guides you to a level of truth. Instead of following the devil's lie, God leads you to truth. And guess what? Yeah, I'm wrong when I tell you about what I deal with, or maybe even what I am still tempted to deal with, because the temptation never stops. When the devil realizes that old thing don't work no more, he'll try to find something else. You see what I'm saying? Temptation is always going to be present. And I used to think because I was tempted, I thought I had already sinned. That's a lie too. Temptation is always coming. But the old school saying, if you heard me say it before, the old school song was, yield not to temptation. But it's, that song said, yield not to temptation. Yield not into temptation. For the yielding is sin. Basically, the yielding means don't do the temptation. For doing the temptation is the sin. Not being tempted to do the sin. Amen? Every child of God is tempted to do something. And you can allow yourself to say you will never fall if you want to. But if that's the case, then the blood of Jesus would never have to be pleaded over us. When Jesus would never have to have come. And so because the word of God tells us that we have to die daily as we're going right back to a full circle. It lets me know that everybody's tempted and everybody got something that they're walking in victory in. Every day you're walking closer to the victory line as long as you keep feeding His Holy Spirit. Amen? Make sense? Make sense? All right, now I want to say this. I always like to open the floor. Do anybody have anything they'd like to share? This is Mother's Day. Do anybody, even though your mama ain't here, you might want to say something. So a shout out, give a shout out to your mama, say, y'all. My mama's here. I love you. I thank you for every prayer, every cry, every tear you wipe, and all the other stuff you had to wipe when I ain't little about. I thank you for every single one of them. I thank you for every long conversation. I thank you for everybody to eat. Every gas money, every car, all a whole lot of stuff. Alright, because you know this is long. So anybody want to give a shout out to your mom? While you're lagging, you know she watching. She watching mom. She makes mom. It's up to y'all. You don't have to. But I'm just asking to open the floor. It's up to you. Floor closing? Up to you. Want me to close it or keep it open? Close it. Alright, you need to tell the other person. Alright, I ain't put you on the front street. I didn't put you on, you know, put you in a situation where you got to do yourself. I just didn't want to be from not having the opportunity. So, guys, you know, we're going to have a song. And then we're going to go into the Word of God. Amen. You know, like I said, God's showed me some stuff, y'all, and I know you said, man, why in the world is he telling us his personal life? What I found out, y'all, because of the way I grew up, nobody that I can remember from the pulpit told their struggles when I was growing up. And so what happened was, as I hit my years of where no longer was I in my childhood, and about the worst thing I would do was disobey mom and daddy, and now mom and daddy came in with a belt and fixed me good. Now I got to a place where now it got to, like in my teenage years, I got a chance to really mess up my life if I chose the wrong thing. And so what ended up happening is, I never, as a child, God, I knew I loved God, but I never heard anybody talk about their struggles. I never heard anybody, even, especially from the pulpit, all I heard was that when you accept Jesus Christ, then you don't do those things no more. Then, now my question is, what's wrong with me? Because I love the Lord, but I got issues. I'm fighting issues and I'm falling in issues. What's wrong with me? And I don't know if anybody has contested that, but that's where I found myself for many years, feeling like something was wrong with me because I love the Lord, I'm trying to walk daily, exactly like he wanted me to walk, but I find myself in a situation almost daily where I'm messing up. And so because I didn't hear much of that growing up, I felt that I was less than a Christian. Well, guess what? As I began to study myself, I found out that Jesus died for that. And that every day there's going to be a struggle. And every day there's going to be some bondages that God has to lead me out of. They may take more than a laying on hands one day. It may take more than me praying a prayer. There are some situations I had to battle to learn how to have compassion for somebody else to still battle in their situation. And I thank God for that because I think to some people, I remember, y'all heard me say my daddy, I heard him my daddy, but he said, hey, I'm going to stop drinking next Wednesday. I'm going to stop smoking next Wednesday, whatever. And next Wednesday came, he stopped. He ended up picking up again. And the thing about it was so weird. 10 years later, he still ain't done it. But he had very little compassion for somebody that didn't do it the same way. Am I telling you the story? He couldn't quite understand why people battled with something so wrong because God, he had, whatever you call it, he had a wrong or he had such a strong will that I'm just not going to do it more. I didn't fall in that category. That wasn't me. That wasn't my story. But through that story, I found out how to have compassion for people that stumble a lot in the same categories, if that makes sense. Makes sense? All right? And so I thank God for my walk. My walk may not be like your walk, but I thank God for my walk because it taught me and still teaching me how to be patient and loving in people in their personal struggles and circumstances because I still tempted in mine. Amen? Any questions? You got a question, Mr. Cat? Alright, so now listen, and that's an awesome question. You said, does God pray for the ones that don't accept God? God's will is for all to accept Him. And so now what happens is you have Jesus that's on the right hand side of God. Remember when Jesus died, he went to the cross and then he rose and now he's sitting on the right hand side of God. So now what Jesus is doing, interceding. Interceding is that intercessory prayer we were talking about earlier. Remember that? That's what Jesus is doing. And the word of God is for whosoever will. So those that don't accept him, Jesus is still right there saying, come on, man. Come on. Still got a little bit of time. Come on. Come on. And every day Jesus is sitting back trying to help people see. You see the situation right here? I did this. Only I did this. You couldn't do this, remember? And he's showing people daily why you need God. Why you need to accept him. And so it's Jesus that is the one that's interceding, trying to make sure that they know to come to God. God doesn't know sin. So God, if you look back at it, and this is probably something you've never done yet, but if you look back at the Old Testament, before Jesus hit the scene, when a person failed and they sinned against God, God often killed them right then and there. It was no, I might repent later on tomorrow. No, God got rid of people right then and there. Like, I remember one instance when he opened up the earth and, like, a whole lot of people fell in because they chose to follow a calf. You see what I'm saying? They made a calf as an idol and they started worshiping the idol and God just killed them all. And so, it's Jesus to answer your question that is praying for those that don't accept him as Lord and Savior. It's him that is praying and telling, hey, God, I know, I lived this. I lived down there. Hey, God, man, just give him a little bit more time. Give him a little bit more time, God. Does that answer your question? That's an awesome question. God, you got any questions? And so, listen, I want y'all to ask questions. Because it's not until you ask the question that we're able to give you an answer and help you get closer to the Lord. Amen? Make sense? All right, so we're going to go into this right here, and then we're going to go into the Word of God. Okay, 1 second, y'all. I apologize for having some technical difficulties. 1 second. Amen. And so, hey, listen, if you're able, if you have at-home ministry, say if you don't watch anybody, make sure that you're giving those that are in your congregation, if it's your children, if it's just you and the children reading a bedtime gospel story, make sure you give the child an opportunity to ask questions. Because it's, believe it or not, God is using you to be their bridge of knowledge to get to know him. So it's important where we ask questions.
See you.
All right. As I said before, God has given us a word this morning. It's almost afternoon. But God has given us a word this morning, and he's been leading us to it just about all morning long. And I thank him for it because all of this sets the tone and the season and get us right to receive the meal. Amen. Don't you do some preparation before you sit down and eat? The devil, what's some of the stuff you do? I ain't talking about you, but I've been trying to teach you how to do a couple little things. Nah, I'm just playing. But what are some of the things you do before you go sit down and eat your meal? You pray. That's one thing. It's preparation to eat. Something else. Thank you. That's the one thing that she struggles with. But yeah. And with that one, that's the one I hope you was going to say. Because that's the one that you struggle with sometimes. But that's the real. And then look, oftentimes you got to prepare the meal. You got to actually cook the meal, right? But there are preparations you do before eating. And guess what? It's the same thing in the spirit. There are preparations. So God's preparing us for this meal right here. The whole entire service, he's preparing us for this meal. And so remember, I said it's coming from this 32nd division of Psalms. Walking into victory is the title that God gave you. And it goes as follows. It says, blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned to the drought of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I had not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the iniquity of my sin. For this cause, everyone who is godly shall pray to you in a time when you may be found. Surely, in a flood of great waters, they shall not come near him. You are my hiding place. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with the songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Do not be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. Bleed glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Let us pray. God, I thank you for your word right now. God, I'm asking, Father, that you will speak with courage. Break it down, Father, in a way that from the youngest to the oldest, and anybody in between, or anybody, whatever condition or mindset that they may be in, God, that they can receive from you. Only you can do this. Only you can do this, and I give you credit for it already in advance. You can do this only through your spirit and not me. So, God, I thank you that you're doing it. For this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Psalm 32nd division of Psalms. So, Father, it goes as follows. Look at verse 1. It says, blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is covered. Now, when you look at transgression, transgression is just another word for sin. All right, so it says, blessed is he whose sin or transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. And so we was talking about this earlier, that the only way that your sins can be covered or your sin can be forgiven is if you have accepted Jesus Christ. You know what, and when my daughter asked this question, is God praying for those that won't accept him? And I'll kind of paraphrase that question. But that's an awesome question because it's not God that's the one that's praying, it's Jesus. He's the one that's interceding. So what happens is God doesn't know sin. But Jesus lived down here when he was born into a fleshly body that had desires like you and I. He was tempted in every single area, but he passed every test. He never sinned. So he knows first beforehand how this thing feels. He knows what it's like. And so he's sitting here saying, hey, man, if they accept me, I did this thing perfectly. And all they got to do is step over into my body, the body of Christ. And it's just like you did this thing perfectly. Like I did. Amen? Because remember when we talked about this thing like the commercials not too long ago about the, like the McDonald's commercial and how they want like all the employees that have been working at that ego, they form a lot of him. Amen? And so that's how God began to show me that the body of Christ is every last one of us that's still alive in this season of life is forming an actual body. And it helped me to understand what being in the body of Christ is really like, because it's like us standing in that covering, that shield of being in the body of Christ with a head, and you got the shoulders and the arms and the waistline. And we form that here on earth. And so we're covered because we're standing in the body of Christ, and Christ did it perfectly. You get it? So verse 1, when it says, blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is covered. Verse 2, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. With that, wait a minute, there was some more left. And in whose spirit there is no deceit. So now what this is saying here, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. God, what this is saying is, blessed is the man that your sins is not being counted. Because guess what? There's always, in the natural mind, in the natural setting, there's cause and effect. You ever heard the term there's repercussions for your action? You ever heard anybody say that? Meaning there's a cause and effect in everything you do. And so, what this is talking about here, blessed is the man whom the Lord does not impute your iniquity. When you fall in, it's not being counted as a child of God, because as soon as you repent for it, when you repent for it, it's like it never happened. It's like it's never happened. It's the same thing that I've heard people talking about this, but God began once again to show me how this works in the natural. I've heard people say that, guess what? I don't have to ask for forgiveness every time because Jesus paid the price for it all. And I can understand that concept, but when I see it played out in the natural, because God does things in the natural to show us how it operates in the spirit. Okay? So guess what? If I did something to you to hurt you, you kind of start to heal and forgive me when I say three magical words. I am sorry. Am I right? If I step on your toe and it hurts you, but I never say I am sorry, you kind of still feel some kind of way about me stepping on your toe. So if I do it again and I don't say I'm sorry, you start to feel a little bit more animosity towards me, right? So by the third time, because I said I'm sorry when I was first born, so that's supposed to cover everything, right? That's why I found a flaw with the fact of saying I don't have to repent because Jesus paid the price for it all. Because in the natural, every time I make a mistake and I hurt you, I need to come back and repent. And if I can't get to you anymore, then I have to stop you. But if I can get my hands to you, Mama, I'm sorry. Ava, I'm sorry. Or okay, I'm sorry for doing blah, 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 then the healing takes place. But if I never say I'm sorry to you, and I'm walking around you all the time like I ain't nothing happened, it takes a hard time. It takes a long time to heal. And so I kind of find it a flaw in the thought process of not ever having to say I'm sorry when I sin against God, because God will never let us be as human beings in the natural needing to say I'm sorry in order for the healing process to take place. So I stay with the fact of repenting for every action. Amen. And asking God to forgive you for things that you know you did and then things you don't even know you did. And just say I'm sorry. Because guess what? In the natural, sometimes we make each other feel wrong and we didn't know we did it. And you might never tell me what I did wrong, but if I come and you say, Mama, I'm sorry for even things I didn't know I did, and I'm sincere about it, healing takes place. If I come and say, I know I miss being at your celebration, and I'm sorry for that. Like, okay, then cool. But also, man, I'm sorry for anything else I did. Then the times that I may have woke you up in the middle of the night, made the noise, I kind of forgive Daddy for that too. You know, I had to go to school, but he being loud, you know, hey, I forgive him for that too. And guess what? God makes that thing too far. forgiveness too. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You're going to want somebody to forgive you for something. And so, it's also because, listen, let me say this when God showed this to me, then we're going to move on. You know, many of us are stuck in our own personal, this is something God gave me this morning, so listen carefully. Many of us are stuck in our own personal bondage because we refuse to forgive. That's what God gave me this morning. And so we think, because I forgave that I should be forgiven. I should be free from something. But guess what? Sometimes you may be stuck in your whole sacred issue. You're a liar and you just can't stop. Why? Because it just seems like it feels so good and you get what you want. So you're stuck in bondage and lying, but it's all directed from you not forgiving so-and-so for a long time ago. See, that's what the devil's trying to get in. And once he got in, you expect him to stick in the category that you let him in. No, It's going back to like when you let the bathroom clean in and start cleaning the house. If you got 10 rooms, you got clean in 10 rooms, right? Well, it's the same thing in the flip side of that. When the devil come in, he trying to park himself in any room. And so if you got an 8-room house, and he started cleaning 6 rooms, there's 2 more rooms he can activate, he can stay in. And so it might not have nothing to do with you. You might not stay close to the door that you came in. He might not stay close to the door that you came in. He walking all over the house. And so you might have to go to the back room to kick him out completely. And so God was showing me this morning that because sometimes we get to the point where we say, I'm just not going to forgive them for that. And now we have a situation where we're stuck in, and every day, every year, we used to battle like, God, can't you hear me, man? I know you got the power. What is up? I'm praying. I'm fasting. Why don't you heal me? Why don't you get me out this job? And God said, it ain't got nothing to do with the job. I need you to forgive, blah, 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 from back in the day. And then when you, once you forgive it, or you forgive her, or you forgive it, or you forgive whatever, could be a situation. You know, sometimes people look at it, check this out, and I'm glad you laughed. What happened is when I said it, I'm going to laugh. Because guess what? The devil comes to try to manipulate your thoughts, right? And so guess what? What happens, so simple as a storm, can come and tear up some. Let's just go here. Let's just go here, okay? Let's just hypothetical. Let's just bring up some sort of example. A storm can come and can take your bicycle and just destroy it. And now you're mad at God because of the storm. And God's like, no. You got this wrong. This ain't what I mean. And so the storm is the it. The energy, the energy. But it's an it. You got it? And so now some people can, because the devil come in immediately say, you see what God did? That's how I never do that. Now I got a bike. You want a bike? You can't even ride it no more. You ain't fit it no more. I got a bike. I can get a bike. You see what I'm saying? And so, but you got to be careful with, and that's where the it comes in with, okay? Thank you for the statement. All right. And it says, blessed is the man, the woman, the Lord, that's not imputed iniquity, and whose spirit there is no deceit. Now check this out. Remember I say God is holy, so be holy. Be holy for God is holy. And it says here that who does not have deceit in their spirit? What is deceit? Cheat you. You have a, I ain't gonna go there. But there are some people that they walk around with that it just seems like everything you better question just about everything they do because they know for cheating, lying. And so God is saying, blesses the man that does not have that in their heart. It's not in their spirit to want to hurt anybody. They won't cheat nobody. You see what I'm saying? Amen? All right, so let's move forward. And it says, when I kept silent, my bones grew old through my running all day long. For day and night, your hands was heavy upon me. So look, what's happening is, this is a situation where a person needs to repent. It says, day and night, I kept silent. For instance. And guess what? Holding that unforgiveness, it makes you hurt on the inside. Now, I'm telling you, God made this thing so clear to us that one thing of holding that sin, next thing you know, is affecting your outer body. Remember, y'all heard me talk about when I went through the cancer situation, and I went through with that, you was very little. You came a couple the pulpits, though, but you might have read it. But when I went through the cancer situation, God showed it. It showed it to me that I was harboring unforgiveness. I was harboring unforgiveness for two people that I can remember right off the bat. And so when you were mentioning their name and I thought I was healed from it, oh, my attitude changed. I had some stuff for them. But when when I finally forgave them, God healed me. You would say, how did those two match? But like I told you, God takes natural things and shows people what's in his spirit. Harboring on forgiveness is like a poison. It's like a cancer, and it spreads in your body, and it makes you sick. Harboring on forgiveness is like a cancer, and it spreads in your spirit, and then it holds you into bondage. And God manifests and shows it to let you know, hey, man, you got something there that I need you to get clean. Amen? All right, so here we go. Verse 4. It says, my fertility, he said, my fertility had turned into the dark summer that comes from him harboring a sin. Alright, verse 5. I acknowledge my sin to you. That's how I know this is what we're talking about. I acknowledge my sin to you and my iniquity I had not hidden, and said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and the Lord forgave the iniquity of my sin. So because he was harboring it, he was hurting. And then when he realized that he was harboring unforgiveness, he confessed it. And God forgave and healed. You got it? Why is that important to know? Because guess what? Living here amongst this earth, the devil's trying to use anybody. Amen? And there are going to be situations in your life that it's going to be harder to forgive people. And a little bit harder than the last situation. But understand, if you don't forgive them, it's only going to hurt you. You get it? You got it? And it may be hard now. I ain't making light of that. There's people that have allowed people into their lives and they killed their whole families. There's people that people trust and they have harmed them for years and haunted them. But if you hold, so I'm just not going to forgive them. Bump them. And then you can be stupid like some people. Now, I ain't going to do that. I'm not going to say it like that. Forgive me. But you can be a fool. Because the Bible calls people fools in some of their ways. You can be a fool and say, I'm going to have to take that to my grave. Well, guess what? Being a fool like that will get you closer to your grave. Because unforgiveness heals and it stifles the spirit, which stifles life in you. And if it's cutting life off, if it's cutting the circulation of life off, what brings, what comes after that? What's the opposite of life? Don't worry about it, I ain't no question. Alright? So, you understand how this works? You understand how it works in the spirit? Y'all get it? Alright, we're gonna move forward because I got to do the whole thing. That's what God gave me, okay? Alright, so it says, but this calls everyone who is God that should pray to you in a time when you may fail. Surely in front of great waters, they shall not come near him. Listen. This is why it's important to talk to the Lord now. Because he's right here. There's going to be a season. Listen, check this out. Let me show you something. Why I know this to be true. There'll be a season in your life where you won't hear from God much. And God is just expecting you to stay there. How do I know that? Check this out. Do you believe there's 400 years in between the Old Testament and the New Testament? Did you know that? That was 400 years that God was saying the word. Kind of hit home though. Like, God, I'm praying over something. I ain't hurt you. God's expecting you to stand on what you want right now. Amen. So it's saying here to pray while you can be found. Okay? It says, surely in front of great waters. This is when you know to just stand. I don't hear you, God, but I know you're there. So it says, surely in front of great waters, they shall not come near him. I can't hear from you, God, but I know your spirit and your word says it shall not overtake me. Psalms 91. Most people know that. It says, you are my hiding place. I'm coming to you, Lord. You're going to come to me. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with the songs of deliverance. Then it says, here, check this out. This is what God means to you. He says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. This is why it's so important to spend time with God. Just like we talked about him earlier and how he'll talk to you. You know he'll talk, right? I can remember the first time. There's a couple of times he spoke to me, time he spoke to me loud and clear. I mean, literally, I'm looking around and I don't see nobody. But he's speaking loud and clear. I'm telling you, you can remember. Don't be dumb like me. I didn't listen. Okay? And I pay into the day. Amen? Alright. He says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is that eye. For the New Testament believers, the Holy Spirit is the eye. I will guide you with my eye. The Holy Spirit is the eye that's teaching and leading us to say, hey, Rocket, don't do that. Rocket, come on over here. God, I don't see nothing over there. You will follow me. But amen, I don't see nothing, Lord. Just follow me. And you get there and you're like, oh, man, can anybody else see it? Nope. Nobody but you. Come on with me. There's your promised land. That's our Father, man. Hallelujah. Alright, so it says, verse 9. Do not be like the horse or like the mule, which hath no understanding, which must be harnessed with butt and bridle, else it will not come near you. You ever watch a horse? Like on TV, man. I ain't talking about the ones you see like on the teacher house. I'm talking about the ones like on TV where they got a saddle and there's a bit going in their mouth and that the rider was sitting back and, you know, the mama knows how to ride a horse. And they guide the horse with the strings that's in the mouth. And so they pull this way, and the horse knows to go this way. It says, and the mule the same way. It says, don't be like them. That it take a strap to guide you. Just listen to the eye. Amen? You think that's funny? I made it look like I know how to ride a horse. Y'all see that? All right. I don't want to look like that. All right. So it says, verse 10, many sorrows shall be to the wicked. But he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. Y'all catch that? You know what you need mercy for? I need all answers. You know what you need mercy for? Why would you need mercy?
Life.
Huh?
Life.
For life. Give me some specifics. Go a little deeper. Why would you need mercy? I'll come back to you.
Keep you out of trouble.
Woo! Come on. Mercy is, it's okay. You stepped on my toe. That hurt him, but I'm going to let you get away with that. Hey, well, why do you keep stepping on this toe? Oh, you think it's funny? Okay, I'm going to let you get away. Just do me a favor. Step back. That's mercy. Not giving you what you deserve for stomping on my toe when I know you did it on purpose. Basically, but it's mercy is like patience in a situation. God gives us mercy because remember I told y'all in the Old Testament, when they people sin, all the time, God killed them right then and there. They didn't get a chance to go back home and get a kill a ram and a lamb and a dove and all that stuff. Sometimes they feel dead right then. Remember we was talking about the married couple? How they cheated God on the land and God told the husband, he lied. You see those people over there? They're going to kick you out. And he died. And the wife came in a couple of hours later. He said, this all the money? Sure, this all the money. He's like, why you lying? You see them people over there? They the same ones carried your husband out earlier. Man, they might have carried you. She died immediately. They ain't get a chance to repent. Well, guess what? Look how many times we bomb every day. Man, you see why Jesus is important? Remember I told you, he's intercede, intercessory prayer, take it up for us? Yeah. God started showing me stuff like that, and then I understood why Jesus is important. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous, verse 11. And shout for joy, all ye upright in heart. You know what makes us upright? You know what makes us upright? Did you catch what that? Let me read it again. It says, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous. That's the answer there. It says, and shout for joy, all ye upright in heart. You know what makes us upright? Jesus. Being in the body of Christ. Because like I said before, we're now, because we're standing in the body of Christ, it don't mean that we still don't blow it. We still sin daily. Let me say, all that sin that comes short of the glory, we still will mess up. But because we're standing in the body, all we have to do is repent. God, I'm sorry. And God looks down and he sees, that's my body. That's my somebody right there. They good. I heard it. I forget. Come on. We ain't gonna keep talking. You know what God told me multiple times when I blew it? Come on, man. I forgave you for that. Let's keep going. You know listen, and we're closing up now. Do you know how much weight that takes off? Because the devil tries to keep you. Why do you do that? Why do you? You can do better. But God tells you, now, hey, come on, let's move on from this. I forgave you already. That's because sin brings bondage and it brings dead weight. And that's when you know you walk around.
And I'm a preacher and I can't get it right.
God knew. God, like, come on, man. I said Jesus for that. Stop. Oh, come on, we got work to do. Come on, let's go. Amen. And so I thank God for the day that this is what He has given us. This is the word that He has given us on today. And so walking in victory refers to us every day because we are feeding the Holy Spirit. Every day. Come in here and feed the Holy Spirit. Don't let the next time we feed the Holy Spirit be next Sunday. Do it daily. And because we're feeding the Holy Spirit daily, and we're spending time with God daily, we are standing strong, and we're getting stronger and stronger, and we're walking closer and closer to the finish line of victory. And whatever situation that you've been dealing with, some stuff you can say, okay, man, I'm just not going to deal with it anymore, and you can walk away from it. But then there's some things that you got to battle. Mm-hmm. Amen? Y'all get it? You get it? All right, so let's stand in the field, and we're going to go out and close. I know the day was a little bit long. We got started late, but like I said, we had some warfare this morning that we had to get into before we got live. So I thank God for what He's doing. We're going to close out in prayer and allow us to continue. For those that are watching, I thank God for you. Don't forget to celebrate Mother's Day. If you are a mother, celebrate yourself if you don't get a phone call or love or any kind of way. Because guess what? You've done a great job. Amen. And nobody's perfect, but you've done the best you can. And at the end of the day, if you know that you've done the best you can, then God will work out the rest. Amen. So let us pray. I thank God for you, God. I thank you for you, the Holy Presence. I thank you, God, for those that have come, for those that wanted to come, for those that have watched. God, feed them, as I said, individually. And I thank you for the meal that they receive coming from you. God, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your joy. We thank you for all, God, that you are doing. We love you, Lord, and continue to help us walk in the path. You said, be ye holy, for you are holy. And thank you, Lord, for putting boundaries up by putting us in the body of Christ and having angels to protect us day and night. So thank you for it all, Lord. We love you, and we bless your name. And, Lord, we keep you forefront in all that we do. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 I love y'all. I'm going to be closing on out right here. Y'all enjoy the rest of your day and do it on purpose. Amen.